Welcome to all in our YouTube channel. Now we are in the chapter of solutions. Now in this chapter, in our last lecture, we have seen some collative properties and osmotic pressure, and we have also derived this equation, that is pi is equal to N2 RT upon V. We already derived this equation in our last video lecture. Now today we will see this point, that is molar mass of solute from osmotic pressure. In another words, that title we can also say that relationship between molar mass of solute and osmotic pressure. That relation now in our today's lecture we are going to see, and we will discuss some points also along with it. Now for dilute solutions we have taken, or we have derived this equation in our last lecture, that is pi is equal to N2 RT upon V. Okay. Now all these terms we have already explained in our last lecture. Again, I will explain here its notations. Pi is nothing but what? Osmotic pressure. And N2 is nothing but the number of moles of solute particles which are present in solution. R is the gas constant. Its value will be constant, you are familiar with that. And T is the temperature, and V is the volume of solution. Okay, so these are the all notations we have used in this equation, and we have termed it as the equation number 1. Okay, now in continuation with that equation, some changes we have made in that equation. This quantity N2 upon V, we are calling that equation it as a molarity. Here N2 upon V is nothing but capital M, that is molarity. This value we have substituted in equation 1, so that equation 1 will convert in this form, that is pi is equal to MRT, and we have termed it as equation number 2. Okay, now we will consider this equation number 1 of mass of solute in V liter. Okay, because molarity, that term we are taking there, so in that point we can say that these two things, W2 is nothing but the mass of solute which we have taken, and M2 is the molar mass of solute, this M2. Okay, then if we want to count the number of moles, then what we have to do, we have to take its ratio, that is as a W2 upon M2, and this value we have substituted in the equation 1, so the equation 1 becomes, okay, W2 upon M2, instead of N2 we have substituted this value, and remaining terms are as it is. And here what we want to show, a relationship between molar mass of solute and osmotic pressure. These two quantities are present here in this equation. So if we make some changes, or by rearranging this equation, you can show the relationship between molar mass of solute, and here this is the molar mass of solute, and pi is the osmotic pressure. What changes we have made here in the above equation, look at here. M2 I have taken here, and pi at the place of M2 I have substituted. Okay, so this, by changing these changes here, we can derive this equation, and I have called this as the equation number 3. So this is the relationship between, what we can say, molar mass of solute M2 and osmotic pressure pi. So this is the simplest derivation. In your exam, this equation may be asked for 2 marks. Okay, this thing you should be keep in mind. Okay, then we will move to the next point, that is collative properties of electrolytes. Now what is mean by electrolytes, you should know first. Electrolytes are those substances which can dissociate very easily, or 100% dissociation takes place. That substances we are calling it as a electrolytes. Okay, and if we classify the electrolytes in different types, we will get strong electrolytes, weak electrolytes. In strong electrolytes, again we can classify it in strong acids and strong bases. Here for weak electrolytes we can again classify it into weak electrolytes and weak acids and weak bases. So this is the in detail classification, but only what we want to hear, what we want to know, that is electrolytes. Okay, as earlier I have mentioned, its dissociation will take place easily, or 100% dissociation will take place for that electrolytes. Here we are measuring its colligative properties. What about the colligative properties? One thing you should know, that if dissociation of electrolytes will take place, it will lead into its corresponding ions. Okay, and if number of ions gets increases, number of fluid particles also gets increases. So this will affect on the colligative property. As early we are familiar with the definition of colligative properties. Colligative properties is such a property in which number of solute particles are very important for the determination of that colligative property. If the number of particles are more, then its colligative property will be also more. So for that reason, for electrolytes, if we study the quantity colligative property, its value will be always more as compared with non-electrolytes. For reference, we have to choose non-electrolytes. Okay. But in case of non-electrolytes, what happens? Dissociation will not take place completely, or we can say 100% dissociation will not be there. So we can compare electrolytes with non-electrolytes. Okay. And some points which I have collected in the form of conclusions. So we should know that these important points for our better understanding. What points we have collected, we will just take a look on that different points. Solutions of electrolytes in water exhibit colligative properties which do not obey the relations of non-electrolytes. Means both the relations are different for electrolytes in water and non-electrolytes in water. Means its values are different from each other. Okay, so this is the important first point we should know. I have pointed out that thing. Okay, here the colligative properties of solutions of electrolytes are always greater than that of the colligative properties of solutions of non-electrolytes. Why this is? Because as early I have explained in detail, it is means number of solute particles affects on the colligative property. Okay, so therefore its value will be more than that of the non-electrolytes. Here again we will come to the next point. Molar masses of electrolytes in aqueous solutions are determined by colligative properties are found to be considerably lower than the formula masses. Okay, this also takes place due to the dissociation. Okay, when we consider the molar masses of electrolytes in aqueous solutions, that is water, when we determine in that case by the colligative properties are found to be considerably lower than the formula masses. Means formula masses are its colligative properties means molar masses of electrolytes is always more than that of the, what you can say, if we compare with formula masses, means its value will be less as compared with the formula masses. Okay, so this is also an important point related to this point, that is colligative properties of electrolytes. Again, when we came across the next point, this is what we can say in the form of question. Okay, why colligative properties of electrolyte solutions are greater than the non-electrolytes? Okay, now look at here. This is the one of the question you should ask before while in lecture. You just go on asking this question. You will get an answer by your responding teacher. Here also I will explain in detail why the colligative properties of electrolyte solutions are greater than that of the non-electrolytes. As early I have mentioned in detail about the number of solute particles, and that number of solute particles affects on the colligative property. Electrolytes, its nature I have already told, its dissociation will be takes place completely or 100% dissociation will takes place for electrolytes. So the number of particles are more in quantity. Therefore, its corresponding colloidal property of electrolytes is greater than that of the non-electrolytes. And this case will not happen for non-electrolytes because of less dissociation. Okay, so this is the answer of this question. Okay, so these are the different factors or different what you can say points related to the colloidal properties of electrolytes. Now we are going to look at the next point, that is Van 't Hoff factor I. Van 't Hoff is the name of the scientist who has discovered this ratio, simplest ratio. What it tells us, that it is nothing but to obtain the colloidal properties of electrolyte solutions by using relations of non-electrolytes. Van 't Hoff suggested that factor we are calling as a small I, or we can denote it with that letter, small I. Okay. Now here Van 't Hoff did a one thing to calculate or to obtain the colloidal properties of electrolyte solution. He has taken a reference of non-electrolytes for that purpose. And what he did, he had taken a simplest ratio like this: observed colloidal property divided by the theoretical colloidal property. And he has applied this this formula for different colloidal properties. In this chapter, we have studied the four colloidal properties: lowering of vapor pressure and the osmotic pressure, as well as elevation in boiling point, depression in freezing point. For all these cases, he has applied this equation. Now we will see one by one. If we apply this above equation for the lowering of vapor pressure, we can construct this equation like this. The observed colloidal property means, if you apply for lowering pressure, lowering of vapor pressure, we can say that observed lowering of vapor pressure divided by the theoretical lowering of vapor pressure. And by taking the ratio of both these quantities, you will get the value of I here. Okay. Again, I have applied for the second thing, that is second colloidal property, elevation in boiling point. What you have to write here? Observed elevation in boiling point divided by the theoretical elevation in boiling point. You just go on applying this equation for remaining two colloidal properties also. What it tells us here? Observed lowering of vapor pressure means, we can write like this. Lowering of vapor pressure, for that purpose we can use this equation, that is observed delta P upon theoretical value of delta P, that is lowering of vapor pressure. You can use this short formula also. Here also, elevation in boiling point, delta TB, we can use here, that is observed delta TB upon theoretical value of delta T. By taking the simplest ratio of these quantities, we can determine the value of I. And for remaining two colloidal properties, that is osmotic pressure as well as another point, that is vapor pressure, osmotic pressure, you can apply this Van 't Hoff factor to that remaining two quantities. And the one thing is that you should keep in mind, when the value of I we are getting in different forms, we will see what are the different cases. If we get the value of I is equal to 1, means if its answer we are getting in the form of 1, then at that time we can say that in that electrolyte there will not be a association or dissociation takes place. Okay, means no association or dissociation takes place in that case. And if the value of I is greater than 1, here we can say dissociation takes place. if the value of I, if it becomes less than 1, then we can say that in that case association will take place. So these are the three cases that you should keep in mind before going, means after getting the value of Van't Hoff factor, that is I. Okay. So these are the different points which we have covered in our today's lecture. Okay. Now in continuation with that, for next videos, you just go on subscribing this channel, so as you will get new updates whenever I am going to be uploaded the next video. Okay. And this will help you for the determination of Van't Hoff factor as well as to derive this equation. Okay. You just go on subscribing this channel and like the videos, just comment it. And those students who are in need with these lectures, you just share to those students also. Okay. Thank you very much for this session. Okay.